to Freud's introduction of you by reading this quote, which we saw in one of your TED Talks. For those who haven't seen it, I really recommend that you search it. So I'm just going to read it. It says, "Hope is the ability to hear the melody of the future, and faith is the willingness and the courage to dance through it today." And Ndidi, I've been so inspired by your story. We've been chatting a little bit online and so wish you could have been here in person with us. But share with us a little bit just about your story before we talk about how you are dancing to the melody of hope today. Just your, you know, you live in Nigeria, you've studied abroad. Tell us a little bit about your journey and, you know, why you returned to Africa. We'd love to hear more about that.
It's a real honor and privilege to be with you all. So I was born and raised in the city of Enugu to a family that actually wasn't a strong Christian family at all. And I was led to Christ by university students who used to come to our house to pick us up for Sunday school. My parents happened to be professors and we lived on the campus. And during the height of the military era in the 1990s, my siblings and I moved to the United States to get our education. My mother is American, so we're able to get financial aid and we went to some of the best schools in the world. I went to Wharton School of the University of Pennsylvania and then Harvard Business School for my MBA and worked with McKinsey and Company in the Chicago, New York, and Johannesburg offices. So I actually lived in South Africa in 1997 and got to spend some amazing time in your great country. God was a big part of my life, and I gave my life to Christ as a teenager. And so even when I was working at McKinsey, I was constantly pursuing purpose and asking God, what do you want me to do at every given time? How can I make sure that I'm living in your will and doing exactly what you've called me to do? And quickly, I started hearing God's voice, actually through anger, what made me angry and how I decided to channel that anger to positive change. So God would place burdens in my heart that would really make me angry. And the first burden was around leadership development, really looking at my continent, the whole continent, and saying, what's going on? We have rulers, we don't have leaders. How can we inspire, empower, and equip a new generation of young people to be leaders of today and tomorrow? And as a young person, I was sold this lie that I was a leader of tomorrow. But these people who were telling me I was a leader of tomorrow kept on taking on the positions. And in their 70s, they were still telling me I was a leader of tomorrow. So LEAP Africa was born in 2002. LEAP stands for Leadership, Effectiveness, Accountability, and Professionalism. And it's a nonprofit organization that now works in 6 African countries, empowering youth to be leaders of today and tomorrow, helping them to become change agents. And now we teach our curriculum on life and leadership skills to teachers who then cascade that curriculum to 14 to 16 year olds. And I stepped out of day-to-day management of LEAP in 2007. And since then have birthed new businesses, co-founded new businesses, or founded them in partnership with my husband and a few of them. The next big one was that made me angry was the food insecurity in Africa. And that has fostered 3 new companies: Ace Foods, which is an agro-processing company. We source locally and process for the local market. We produce spices and complementary foods. Sahel Consulting, which is my day job. And Sahel is really focused on catalyzing innovative solutions to agriculture's food and nutrition challenges. And most recently, Nourishing Africa, which is a digital platform that connects entrepreneurs and provides funding to entrepreneurs in the food and agriculture landscape committed to unlocking this $1 trillion industry. And Christ has been at the center of everything I've done, and really the desire to die empty, the desire to be a change agent, the desire to transform the ecosystems in which I work. And I guess you can call it redemptive entrepreneurship. I didn't have the right terminology, but thanks to Andre, we're learning every day.
Thank you, Ndidi. In all of this, you're a very busy woman. There's a lot that you do and that you're involved with. Where does God fit into this? You said you didn't grow up in a Christian family and sort of somewhere along the way, you found relationship with him. What is your take on your faith and work interaction? How do you bring God into your day-to-day life and or more into your work life? How do you marry those and how does that influence what you do?
So it affects everything I do. I'm a very public Christian figure in Nigeria. And I didn't get comfortable professing my faith so easily in the beginning. Imagine working for McKinsey in the United States. But actually, in my early days at McKinsey in the US, I actually started a Bible study in the office. And we used to meet at 7 a.m. And that was pretty profound for the US. But we did it at 7 a.m. so we wouldn't disrupt anybody coming in you know, that early. But over time, I've gotten more confident and comfortable being very vocal about my faith. And actually, the first book I wrote was called Working for God in the Marketplace. And it was case studies of business professionals who were struggling to reflect Christ in the business world. I changed all the names of the people I interviewed, but I felt it was important for me and others to learn how to reflect Christ. So I see myself as an apostle in the marketplace. I'm also part of a group in Nigeria started by some friends called Apostles in the Marketplace. And what we believe is that as Christians in the business world, we're called to be the light of the world, the salt of the earth. We're called to channel resources and credibility to the faith. And we're called to reflect Christ in everything we do. So while I run secular organizations, and none of my organizations are Christian organizations per se, I'm very vocal about my faith. All my team members recognize that I'm a Christian. We do pray in the office. And through my work and my life, I try to reflect Christ in everything I do.
Amazing. Thank you. So you have lived everywhere in the world, other continents, different countries. Why did you return to Nigeria? Why Africa? And why is your heart rooted here?
Well, I believe that nothing happens by chance. And I believe I was born here for a reason. But more than that, I believe we are called as Africans to demonstrate God's love and God's compassion. And, you know, the amazing thing is, you know, the choice to come back to Nigeria was one that God placed in my heart. And I believe our father is a master strategist. I never applied for a job in Nigeria. I never thought I'll ever return to Nigeria. And I got an offer in the mail while I was an undergrad at Wharton, an offer to come and work in Nigeria. I never planned on coming. I've never heard of giving someone an offer when they didn't send their resume and without an interview. But I got this offer and I worked in Nigeria for the summer and it was the most amazing experience. So that's how God found me. God said, I'm going to give you a job without an interview, all expense pay trip, come back and see what work I have for you. And the truth is, every single day I work and see the impact of my work, I recognize that as Christians, we have to be the change agents in Africa to transform Africa in the face of all the challenges. Now, in the food and agriculture sector, God has blessed us. We are naturally endowed for agricultural excellence. There's no reason why we should be net importers of food. There's no reason why one out of every three African children should be stunted. Even in South Africa, it's the same statistics. It's a travesty. So I believe God has called me into this sector and called many of you into this sector to feed Africa, but also to feed the world, because we have the most abundant arable land left in the world. So this sector in particular is so important to God's heart. And I believe I'm called to do something in the sector, but I also am recruiting more change agents who are led by Christ to come into this sector and transform the sector.
Talk to us a little bit. I know you are very passionate about collaboration and you're very outspoken about collaborating between different religions and denominations and, you know, you know, many Christians say, oh, should I only work with Christians? How do I deal with sort of the outside world? You have a very passionate take on that. So talk to us a little bit about what you believe we can achieve if we collaborate with each other and also with other industries around us, no matter where you come from and what you believe and how you, you know, how you see the world. So just chat a little bit about your conviction around collaboration with us.
Thank you. So some of you might not be aware, but Nigeria is 50% Muslim, 50% Christian. And that statistic definitely puts us in a very unique position as a country, because on a regular basis, in fact, many of our meetings start, official meetings by the government start with a Christian prayer and a Muslim prayer. And so if you are a Christian who says, you know what, I'm only going to work with Christians, I don't believe you're reflecting Christ. Because Christ has sent us to the world to serve as that light of the world, the salt of earth, and to demonstrate his kindness, his goodness, to occupy, but also to draw people unto him. And so for me, it's been very important to create spaces where people can be drawn into the environment, where they can work with each other, and where through the joy they see in you, the peace they see in you, the work ethic and the commitment to excellence, they want to know the Lord you serve. And so that's been very important. That's been a principle that has shaped how I've worked. The second is that in our country, and I'm sure many of your other countries, denominations, even in Christendom, have almost become restrictive. So you're Pentecostal, you're Baptist, you're Catholic, and there's competition. And we are not reflecting Christ when we compete with each other. And so I call myself non-denominational, and I have many big pastors who are my friends, who I interface with, and I don't belong to anyone, I belong to Christ. And I think in our faith, by these divisions, we're actually shattering what Christ came to teach. I don't know how many of you have been to Jerusalem. So I had the opportunity to work in Ramallah in the Palestinian territory when I was a student. And I spent a lot of time in Jerusalem. And it hurt me deeply when I would go to the Church of the Holy Sepulchre and see every single denomination doing the walk to the cross. Every single denomination after denomination, Christian denominations. And I said, if Christ was here, he would weep. What is the difference between our denominations? We have one thing in common and we're called to achieve one thing, and yet we're splitting hairs. And so through my work, I've tried to unite faiths, unite the Christian faith first, so that we can have a common voice to speak against issues with credibility and authenticity. But also I think we're wasting a lot of our resources. And I talk about this in my TED Talk. We have churches that are empty throughout the week, and yet we have overcrowded classrooms. We have overcrowded hospitals. In many of our villages, there's no post office, there's no hospital, and yet there's a church or mosque. And I feel like these physical assets can be channeled to such good. The same with our financial assets as people of God and how we're channeling them. And so that really frustrates me. And then there's the whole issue of this prosperity message that is being preached across Africa, which I feel is very destructive. And we're not holding our religious leaders accountable for how they utilize our resources. But one final thing is that when you think about the strength of churches and the strength of the Christian faith, Redeemed Christian Church of God, a Nigerian church, is present in 167 countries. In many of these countries, for the diaspora populations, they're the only link to financial services, to all sorts of things. And they are even stronger than our envoys, our ambassadors. We're not leveraging them. So for me, I think if we want to impact social change and we want to truly transform lives, especially on issues, controversial issues in Christian faith, such as family planning, voter registration, even wealth creation, vocational training, we have to work with faith-based organizations. So my message has always been cross the divide and focus on a common agenda around social change. And then you'll see that we have more in common within the Christian community and more in common with others. And together, we can really transform Africa. And that's been my message through the work I've done to create, widen the pie. Instead of fighting for a small pie, let's grow the pie. And let's demonstrate that as Christians, we can create wealth, we can make a difference, we can impact the lives of people, and we can demonstrate that God really loves Africans and that in this continent, we can get it right. And that's my mantra and my motivation.
I'm trying to think if it's appropriate if I now drop my mic on behalf of yours. But that was amazing. Thank you so much. You said earlier, and I loved when you said you believe that Africa, we can feed Africa and we can also feed the world. What is your hope for Africa as a continent and its significance in the world in the next 5 years? What do you see happening in Africa? You know, we talk a lot about, one of our strong themes for this conference is Africa, your time is now. And you are, passionate about that as well. What do you believe is Africa's time and what would it be in the next 5 years?
Well, one of the reasons I got into the food ecosystem is that when I moved to the US at 16, the face of an African child and the face of Africa was a hungry child, a hungry, starving child. And that upset me. Again, it made me angry. And it made me channel my energy to change that narrative. So my hope for Africa is in a continent where every child that grows up in this continent can live a full and meaningful life, can achieve their God's given potential, can be a transformational leader, and can change their community and change the world. Now, Africa as a continent, my desire is that Africa will be the most respected continent, that from Africa, because we have now the largest number of Christians in terms of any continent, that as a continent, we will demonstrate Christ's love, Christ's spirit of excellence, and will stand shoulder to shoulder with any other continent when it comes to life expectancy, which is, I'm hoping we'll get to the 90s. Every African will live a full and meaningful life. When it comes to unemployment, single digits. When it comes to food self-sufficiency, we'll be self-sufficient. So when we look at all the indicators, but from a spiritual perspective, that we will be the light of the world and salt of the earth. And I keep on coming back to it, that people will come to Africa for ideas on innovation, that this continent will teach the rest of the world how to live because we live well, because we take care of ourselves and we take care of each other. And that takes a mindset shift to believe we can do it, but it also takes us working together across countries in ways like never before to demonstrate what is possible. I want to see it in my lifetime, and I believe working together, we can achieve it. I'll end with my favorite quote, my current favorite quote, because it's a Christian quote. We used to say this as children, this prayer by St. Francis of Assisi. You know, I'm sure some of you have said it, God grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. We've changed that, and a young African changed that, and that's my mantra. It says, I'm no longer asking God to grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change. I'm asking the Almighty to grant me the courage and wisdom to change the things I cannot accept. And I cannot accept that Africa cannot feed itself and the world. So God is going to grant us that courage and that wisdom to change the things we cannot accept. And I hope you'll adopt that mantra as well. God bless you all. It's been a pleasure.
Thank you, Ndidi. I wish you could have been in the studio. There were a lot of agreements and amen. So thank you for that. And again, for your time. And I actually can't think of a better introduction. As we said, you know, in our correspondence to you, this event is really about celebrating our 2020 Trigger Accelerator Fellows. And Floyd will share more on them. But we're actually starting off with three of our ventures, which are in the food industry. So Ndidi, thank you just, you know, for, I heard them all very loudly say yes and amen to everything you were saying. So without further ado, I'm going to hand over to Floyd, and we're going to open the stage for our fellows.